Today, May 26, the day we're recording this video, SARS-CoV-2 has infected more than 5 million people worldwide. And this is what we call a pandemic. But how did we reach, in such a short time, these numbers starting from just one infected person, patient zero? Well, the first case infects a small number of people. Now there are three infected people, and each infects another small number of people. But as the number of infected grows, the infection spreads faster. Let's try to express this phenomenon in numbers. At the beginning, there is only one infected person, the so-called patient zero. So let's imagine, for simplicity of calculation, that each infected person infects one person per day. So this is the infectious rate, that is to say, the average number of people that an infected person infects every day. So, the infectious rate depends on the number of daily contacts of an individual, multiplied by the probability that contact leads to contagion. So let's say that our patient zero meets 4 people every day, and the probability of contagion is 1 out of 4. So, the number of infected people the next day will presumably be 1, our patient zero who has not healed yet, plus 1, the first infected. Remember that in our pattern, every infected person only infects 1 other person every day. So the formula we use can be rewritten by factoring out the number of infected people on day zero. So, similarly, we can predict the number of infected people on the second day. So, 2 infected people on their previous day, plus 1 new infected each, for a total of 4 infected people. So, the same reasoning applies to the third day. The 4 people who got infected the previous day, plus 4 new infections for a total of 8. So if we try to rewrite the formulas we use referring to day zero and not to the previous day, it is easy to generalize the equation and get the number of infected people on any day. So you should be quite familiar with this type of equations, since it's an exponential equation. So this means that as the days go on, the number of infected people grows faster and faster. And as you can see, after only 7 days, the number of infected people no longer fits on the screen, which is why the evolution of an epidemic is often represented on a logarithmic scale. The logarithmic scale is a non-linear scale that shows large variations of a variable in a compact way. And this is because the scale shrinks as the variable grows. The intervals become progressively larger, and what remains constant is the ratio. In a logarithmic scale, the spread of the infection seems to have a linear trend. And this is because the logarithm is exactly the inverse function of the exponential, the function that drives increase of infections. Well, keep in mind that the logarithmic scale only changes the representation of the data, but not its value. Things seem to go straight, but they might be already out of control. Well, the number of infections, however, cannot grow forever. Sooner or later, there will be no one left to infect, and the spread will finally stop. In fact, when most of the population is infected, the epidemic spreads more and more slowly, because there are fewer and fewer susceptible individuals. So if we take this factor into account, the growth curve of this infection takes a form called logistics. At first, it grows exponentially, and then it reaches a point of inflection and slows down until it stops. Well, the logistic function, therefore, describes the natural growth of infections much better. However, it only shows the total number of people who are infected and does not take into account that a COVID-19 patient does not remain contagious forever. After a certain time, although the span may vary, the patient heals or worst case scenario, dies. Technically, we speak of removed because, from a mathematical point of view, it does not matter whether an individual heals or dies. What matters is that this patient can no longer infect or get infected. So, if we multiply the infectious rate, that is to say how many people are infected daily by an infected person, by the number of days the individual is contagious, we can calculate how many secondary infections each infected person will determine in total during his or her illness. And this is the famous reproduction number, or R0. We can also interpret R0 as the ratio between the infectious rate and the recovery rate. The reciprocal duration of a disease represents the portion of infected individuals that is removed every day. The reproduction number is therefore an n-dimensional parameter that derives from the ratio of two rates. Technically, we use the term R0 only to refer to when the epidemic breaks out, that is to say when the whole population is still susceptible. But as the epidemic progresses, the number of secondary infections caused by an infected person decreases because most of the people he or she comes in contact with will already be infected or immunized. The reproduction number, therefore, varies over time, and for this reason, its value is referred to as RT. RT is used to assess the direction of an epidemic. An RT greater than 1 is indicative of an expanding epidemic, and RT equal to 1 is indicative of a stable epidemic. The objective is to maintain RT smaller than 1, which is an indicator of epidemic extinction. The reproduction number evaluates the effectiveness of the containment measures applied by a state to monitor the epidemic evolution during the resumption of normal activities. Well, at this point, I understand that some confusion may arise between the differences between the reproduction number and the infectious rate. Well, the infectious rate is an index of the spread at which individuals are infected and describes the speed at which the total number of infected people increases. The reproduction number instead describes a balance or imbalance between the speed with which individuals become infected and the speed with which they resolve the infection. The RT provides information on the evolution of the active infections, that is, the number of people who are infected every day and who may require treatment at the same time. Keeping the RT low is important so that healthcare professionals can manage all patients adequately within the limits of their resources. So when we talk about flattening the curve, this is exactly the curve we're talking about, the curve of active infections. But what can we do to reduce the reproduction number and flatten the curve then? Well, as we said, RT depends on the infectious rate, the number of new infections generated by an individual, and the unit of time and duration of the infection. We can still break down beta as the number of contacts for the probability that each contact will transmit the infection. So number one thing that we need to consider is that RT goes down by limiting the number of daily contacts to the bare minimum. Number two, respecting social distancing, washing your hands, wearing masks are all ways to reduce the probability of transmitting the infection to each person we come in contact with. Number three, finally, staying at home and self-isolation at the first suspicious symptoms can also significantly limit the time for which each infected person can infect others and effectively reduces RT. So we all therefore have the responsibility and the power to change the evolution of this pandemic. So let's be careful and stay indoors to make RT lower than 1.